Welcome back, everyone. In this video, we're going to continue learning from Chapter 1 of the ebook, Lessons 2 and 3. We're going to be looking at Avogadro's number, as well as ions and molecules. After reading those chapters and watching this video, you should be able to apply the technique of dimensional analysis to various chemical problems. You should be able to use molar mass to determine mole quantities from mass amounts and mass quantities from mole amounts. And then using Avogadro's number and the mass-mole relationship, you should be able to calculate the masses of individual atoms, molecules, mole quantities from mass amounts, and vice versa, and be able to determine the number of particles as well from masses or mole amounts. So atoms, we talked about in the past that an atom is the smallest subatomic particle that represents a given element. And it turns out that atoms are usually either found in molecules or is in extended networks. So a molecule is where you have a group of atoms held together by chemical bonds. We'll learn later that those are called covalent bonds. And these have a discrete shape and a discrete quantity of atoms that are involved in a very particular ratio. Ions, however, they tend to form extended ionic networks, as opposed to just a single molecular unit. So, for example, sodium chloride isn't just sodium and chloride ion, but it's actually thousands upon thousands and millions upon millions of sodium and chloride ions that are together in a crystal structure. Whereas the molecules, such as methane and ammonia and water that are shown on the left, those will have distinct molecular structures. Water is always H2O, and you can isolate, or you could think about isolating a given water molecule. But you can't do that for ionic structures. The formation of molecules and ionic networks is due to how the electrons arrange themselves. The nuclei themselves do not change. The hydrogen that are in hydrogen molecules reacting with oxygen to form water, those remain as hydrogen and as oxygen. They don't change identities as elements, but as a molecule, they do change. We can represent molecules in a variety of different ways. This is, if we look at ribose, which is a sugar molecule, it forms the backbone of RNA. It has a molecular formula, C5H10O5. We can represent that in a variety of different forms. There's the structural formula, there's the ball and stick model, and there's the space filling model. And you can see that each of these different representations has some pros and some cons. The structural formula is a little bit neater. You can see what elements are involved. Whereas the space filling and the ball and stick model, it's based on the colors that they are representing. The space filling model shows what actually is being occupied by the electron clouds, whereas the ball and stick model is a little bit easier to tell what elements are involved versus the space filling model. And so we can represent these molecules in a variety of different ways. Let's now talk about Avogadro's number. So Avogadro's number is a specific amount, and we can relate masses using grams and AMU using Avogadro's number. In other words, if you take Avogadro's number worth of AMU, that's equal to the mass of 1 gram. So Avogadro's number is equal to 6.02214 times 10 to the 23. And we often shorten this down to just 6.022 times 10 to the 23. If you have a collection of objects and you have Avogadro's number worth of those objects, we call that a mole. So a mole of something is 6.022 times 10 to the 23 of that object. If we write out Avogadro's number, that's what we have. And that is approximately equal to a trillion trillion. So Avogadro's number is so large, you take a trillion of something and you take a trillion of that trillion, and that is approximately equal to Avogadro's number. So it's approximately a trillion trillions. And Avogadro's number tells us, again, it's the number of objects in one mole. And so it can be talking about atoms, it can be talking about molecules, it can be talking about electrons or anything. You could have a mole of literally anything. You could have a mole of bananas. Okay? You could have a mole of hats. You could have a mole of moles. A mole is not specific. It came from chemistry, and it came from dealing with atoms and molecules and getting large quantity masses, but it is not isolated to chemistry. You could have a mole of anything. So a mole of atoms is what is contained when you weigh out a mass equal to its atomic mass. So in other words, a mole of carbon has 12.0107 grams and contains Avogadro's number worth of atoms, 6.022 times 10 to the 23 atoms. If you have that many atoms, that's 12 grams. And that's what would be the mass for carbon. It would be different for different elements because they have different masses. For example, a mole of ribose has a mass of approximately 150 grams and contains that same number of molecules as a mole of carbon. So in other words, if you were to look at a mole of carbon, you would see 12 grams. If you look at a mole of ribose, you have 150 grams. And so you have a different amount, a different mass of substance, because each of those elements involved weigh different amounts. To find the molar mass of a molecule, you take the number of a given element times its atomic mass. So for ribose, we have 5 carbon atoms. You multiply by the mass of carbon to get a total of 60 grams. There are 10 hydrogen atoms. And so each one of those weighs approximately 1 gram per mole to get you 10 grams. And you have 5 oxygen atoms, each of those weighing 16 grams. And all of these atomic masses you can get from the periodic table. You add all those together and you get the molecular mass of the ribose. So if you had 1 mole of ribose, it would be 150 grams. You can perform similar operations for other molecules, methane or water. You simply add together the number of each atom times the mass of that atom. And we can interconvert between mass, moles, and the number of particles. Again, a mole is 6.022 times to the 10 to the 23 of something. If you take the number of moles, let's say we have 5 moles, and you multiply by the molar mass, you're going to get the mass in grams of 5 moles. If you take 5 moles and you divide by Avogadro's number, you multiply by Avogadro's number, then you know how many particles you have. So you'd have 5 times 6 times 10 to the 23 number of particles. Let's try an example here. So sugars that are used to make soda typically have the formula C6H12O6, that is sucrose. And a typical can of soda contains about 39 grams of sugar. How many moles of sugar are in one can of soda? How would we do this? The way that we would do this, we want to find the number of moles of sugar. And remember what we saw before. We can go from mass to moles using the molar mass. So we know we have 39 grams. We want to find how many moles. So what we need is the molar mass. The molar mass is found by taking the number of a given element times the mass of that element. So we have carbon. We have hydrogen. Again, these numbers come from the periodic table. And we have oxygen. 6 oxygen atoms, 12 hydrogen atoms, and 6 carbon atoms. Add those together to get 180 grams per mole. Then we know we have 39 grams of sugar per can, and divide that by the molar mass. Our units of grams of sugar are going to cancel, and we're left with the number of moles of sugar in the can. And so that's going to be more than 0.001 and less than 1 mole. Now you try this problem. Go ahead and pause the video and try this on your own. Welcome back. Let's work through the solution. We want to know how many hydrogen atoms are in 25 milligrams of ibuprofen. Well, remember from before that we know there's a relationship between mass to moles and from moles to the number of particles. We're given the mass. We want to find number of particles, so we need to now find the number of moles. What's the relationship that goes from mass to moles? That's molar mass. The relationship that goes from moles to particles is Avogadro's number. So to find the molar mass, you add together the number of carbon times its atomic mass, the number of hydrogen times its atomic mass, and the number of oxygen times its atomic mass. We get a total of 206.29 grams per mole. To find out how many moles that is, we're going to convert from milligrams to grams, and then use the molecular weight, or the molecular mass of the ibuprofen. Our units of grams will cancel, and we're left with the number of moles. Then we want to find the number of particles. So here's where you need to be careful, because it's not just going to be the number of moles times Avogadro's number, because this is the number of molecules of ibuprofen. If we want to find out how many hydrogen atoms there are, we need to also multiply by the number of hydrogen atoms per molecule. Once you do that, you get the number of hydrogen atoms total, and this is in 25 milligram sample. Okay. So we finished up talking about the subatomic structure. We're dealing with protons and neutrons. We've talked about isotopes. We've talked about percent abundance and the isotopic mass, the average atomic mass. We're now going to move on to electrons. We talked about earlier how the protons and neutrons are stored in the nucleus. But where are the electrons? We know that they're around them in what we call the electron cloud. But in order to really figure out where they are, we need to start talking about energy. And so that's where we're going next. Thanks for watching. If you have questions, you can ask on Piazza, in office hours, recitation, or during the help sessions. Have a good day.